Hello, and welcome to this week's edition of Walking in His Presence. I'm Pastor Dave Lasek, pastor of In His Presence Church right here in the South Hills, and it is an absolute privilege to come to you via BPTV and Peters Township Cable Television to share with you, as God lays on our heart on a weekly basis, just different thoughts, different things to hopefully encourage you, as well as maybe challenge you a little bit in your walk with the Lord. Our hope is that we share some things that from this show that'll make you stop and maybe think a little, maybe cause you to say, hey, wow, I never thought about that this way. Is it going to be earth-shattering? Probably not, but that's okay. That's okay. If it just causes us to stop and think, or maybe to challenge us to, hey, why don't I do things that way? How come things are the way they are? Or can I do something a little bit different? And do I really think this way like the Bible says? You know, the Bible is an incredible book, really. It just causes us to think in ways that are not like our ways. They're just not the ways that we would normally think. And for that reason, I have a question for you today. It actually causes us to think in peculiar thought patterns and think of things and take a look at things that at first glance just say, well, wait, how can that be? And isn't that interesting? Because isn't that what Nicodemus, one of the most learned scribes, said to Jesus? Well, how can these things be? He said to Jesus. Well, I'm challenging you to ask that same question. That you hear things that are in the Bible. You hear things maybe on Sundays when your pastor's preaching. Like, to stop and say, how can these things be? Man, I never thought about it that way. Well, I have a question for you today on this week's show, and that is this. How peculiar are you? Some might say, oh, if I could tell you. Others might say, peculiar? I'm not peculiar. Peculiar means strange or weird. No, it also means different. How peculiar are you? And I was preparing for this message, and I said, Lord, what do you want us to realize now in this season, in this time? What is it that you're drawing us into as a people, and to prepare our hearts for the upcoming season? You know, the whole world realizes that there is a holiday season just around the corner. But do you know that in the natural as well as in the spiritual, we need to begin preparing for that? We need to begin to get ready. I mean, I look at it this way. Every year is not just another Christmas. It's a special Christmas. Every year is not just an opportunity to give thanks for everything God has. It's an opportunity has given us. It's an opportunity for us to give thanks for the things God has added to us this year. And so I take a look at this time and this season in a unique way. And I want to make sure that I'm prepared. Yes, you know, we all try to prepare financially for Christmas because our heart's desire is to give. We want to prepare for maybe travel over Thanksgiving. But have you taken a consideration to prepare your heart for this season? And that's a little different perspective. Have you prepared, or are you preparing your heart for this upcoming season? And those kinds of questions, those kinds of thought processes and patterns make us different from the rest of the world, make us in a good way. It makes us stop and say, hey, there's more to life than just my own little world. That, as most people would be looking onto, that, as most people would be looking at, would classify us as peculiar. But isn't that what we've been called to be? Isn't that what the scriptures tell us? Well, it is very point blank, direct in calling us a peculiar people. You know, as Jesus was teaching, he was teaching principles and patterns, and it was blowing people's minds what he was saying. He said, if someone comes up to you and steals your coat, give him your tunic too. And people would say, what? You're nuts. How in the world can you say that? This guy just robbed you, and you're saying, don't rob you, give him more. That's peculiar. That's strange. The Bible is full of principles and doctrines that seem completely outlandish to most people. And you know that if you're walking in that way, you need to know, if you don't know already, that you are walking according, not all things, not crazy things, you know, that are harmful and things like that, but biblical things. You are walking according to the scriptures. And God would call you. He has a name for that. He has a name for us. It's not, you may think it's not a real flattering name, but he calls us a peculiar people. So if you have your Bible, why don't you open up with me? In the back of the New Testament is the letter to Titus from the Apostle Paul. And we're going to start there. We're going to start in Titus chapter 2. In Titus chapter 2, Paul was trying to teach his young disciples, young pastor Titus, some things about this peculiarities of the Christian faith. What set Jesus apart? Let's take a look in verse 14. In verse 14, he tells young pastor Titus this. Let ours also learn. Oops, I'm sorry, I'm in 2:14. There we go. He's talking about the Christian life. He begins in verse 11. I'll just back up to there. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. A peculiar people. That's an interesting term. In here, he's very clearly saying that God has chosen to his people to be different. He has chosen his people to not be like other men, to not be in the same veins, in the same processes, to not process things the same as other men. He calls it in this particular text a peculiar people. You know, when you see somebody doing something a little different than what the norm is, when you see somebody, let's take this instance for example. So you're in a work situation, and someone, for whatever reason or purpose, though through no fault of your own, is causing life to be maybe a little bit miserable for you. The normal thing, the worldly thing, the common sense human thing would be to put up a shield or fight back even. But how about if you did this? How about if they come and, you know, I don't know, being real elementary here, how about if they come and they take a pen or something off your desk that they know you really like, that they know that it was special to you? How about if you filled up a cup of coffee and brought it over to them because you know that they like that? How about if you, the next day, bought them one of those pens and now they had two, including yours? That's peculiar. That is strange. That's the kind of thing that just blows men's minds. And Jesus was doing that all the time. Men would stay away from leopards. Jesus embraced them. Men would stay away from sinners and not want to be associated and have their reputation tainted by an affiliation with a sinner. Jesus would go be with them. Those are the kinds of things that were flipping people out. They said, this guy, he doesn't follow the society norms. He doesn't follow things like other men. He's different. He's set apart. You know, we automatically take a look at the word peculiar and we say, wow, I don't want to be peculiar, because we have a bad connotation. But how about if we use that term in other contexts? I could tell you right now that let's just pick Peyton Manning. Peyton Manning, especially in his playing days, he's set for the Hall of Fame. He was a peculiar quarterback. He was head and shoulders above the rest. He played well. He played exceedingly above other quarterbacks in the league at his time. How about, that's just using a sports example. Barry Lemieux, when he was on the ice, he was a peculiar hockey player. Isn't that kind of using that term a little bit different? Do we all of a sudden start thinking about that word differently? And when we use it in those contexts, when we use it in that way, all of a sudden we would say, boy, I wish I could be that peculiar. I wish I had the talent to be that kind of a peculiar player in sports. But that's what God's calling us. He says we're a peculiar people, that we take a look at life, and because of the principles and the power of the Holy Spirit, we can take a look at life and do life differently based on the principles of the Word, based on the Bible, based on the example of Jesus Christ. Let me read that again. It says, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. So what this is telling me is a peculiar people are those who are redeemed, who are taken out of iniquity, which is sin and self-will. They're a strange people who don't do their own bidding anymore. That's a peculiar people. They have been redeemed from iniquity and purified. Now, it doesn't take a rocket scientist for anyone to realize and to admit that we are challenged daily in the area of purity, both male and female. And yet, a peculiar people, one pulled apart or pulled away or pulled out of that normality, are both redeemed from iniquity, which says, I'll do things my way regardless, my way or the highway kind of thinking, and to purify unto himself this peculiar people. So a peculiar people, let me change the context, change the thought process of what this word is identifying. This word is identifying as peculiar those people who want to back off and stay away from sinful thought, action, and deed. sinful thought, action, and deed, which is self-will, which is iniquity. So God is saying, I am going to redeem from all iniquity and purify them. You know, purity is an internal as well as an external condition. There is a, you know, we could use the word cleanse, and you purify your plates every night after dinner's over because you cleanse them from the remains or the things that are on the plate from dinner. But how about you? How about your heart? How about your soul? Are you willing, or do you place yourself in a position for God to remove you from iniquity and purify you unto himself? God has such a desire to do that in each one of us. And it's not only God's desire, we need to make that our desire. We need to say, Lord, keep me away from my thoughts. Keep me away from those things that would lead me down paths that are not of you. Lord, teach me exactly how to walk out this Christian life. Teach me how to keep myself pure. And you know, that's purifying yourself and staying away from iniquity. Those are intentional things. You don't just fall into purity. You don't just avoid self-willful thoughts that are against God's direction and word. Those are intentional decisions. Those are intentional actions. You know, it's the easiest thing for me to use as a as an example is the remote control of your television. Okay? Do I want to watch what I want to watch? Or should I really not be watching that show? Do I want to keep myself away from those things on TV that I know lead me in wrong directions? Do I want to keep those things out of my thoughts, out of my vision, out of my hearing? Am I willing to intentionally move from iniquity and purify my life? Now, it's interesting because when you make that decision, you're going to be different, peculiar from the rest who choose not to make that decision, who choose not to turn off things they shouldn't be watching, who choose not to continue to do things that they shouldn't be doing. That makes you peculiar. That makes you different. But in this instance, peculiar is a good thing. In this context, a peculiar people is a cherished group of people to God. And isn't that what we're trying to do with our Christian walk? Walking in his presence is about how do we continue to move on in our walk with the Lord to be separate from my will. Not my will. Even Jesus said, not my will, Father, but yours be done. How do we separate ourselves and separate those will, that will and emotions and that desire? Well, first of all, we have to know what God, the Father's will is. And so we need to invest ourselves in learning the will of the Father. Invest ourselves in the teachings of the Bible. Because when we understand and when we know what God's desire of us is, then we can take our desires, our iniquities, and lay them at the altar and say, no, not my will, just like Jesus, not my will, Father, but yours be done. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to advance in your relationship and your walk with the Lord, your closeness to God intentionally by laying down iniquity, by laying down your thoughts, by laying down your desires and saying, like Jesus, not my will, but yours be done. You know, that one statement, and if you're not familiar with where it is in the Bible, that was the prayer that Jesus spoke in the Garden of Gethsemane. And when I heard and read that prayer for the very first time, I was absolutely transformed. Because I saw a man praying unto to drops of blood because it was not his will to be separate from the Father. Because he knew that as soon as he took on sin, his relationship with God the Father would change. It would come apart. He would have to be separate because God cannot look on sin. Not my will, but yours be done, Father. That's renouncing iniquity. That's renouncing our own way and saying, Father, your way. I want to walk your way. Jesus knew no sin, but he took our sin upon himself so that we can walk in free from iniquity and be purified in our inner man by the grace of God. Are you willing to lay down those things that are directing you in paths that even you know you shouldn't be going? Not my will, but yours be done, Lord. Well, God has given us a couple different places here. The other scripture that I had for you today is from the book of 1 Peter. In 1 Peter chapter 2, in verse 9, it says this. Let me put my glasses. It says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Here's that word again, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. The subtitle in my Bible in that area is called God's Own People. You are a chosen people. You're chosen to walk a peculiar life. A peculiar life to the world, but a holy life before God. Wow, where does the time go? This statement, a peculiar people, is one that I'm hoping and praying that you would embrace. Not to just run with the crowd. And you know, that's the biggest challenge I see in young people today, is they want to be part of the crowd. And if the crowd's going off the cliff, what then? Choose instead to be a peculiar person, a peculiar people. Choose to be a leader, leading people in the right direction, maybe even the opposite direction. God has called us to be that particular group of people. And he's chosen us for that particular task. Well, the time has gotten away from us, and we'll come back to this verse here in 1 Peter next time, Lord willing, and we'll talk about being a peculiar people and how we can take a look at this upcoming holiday season in a peculiar kind of way. I'm Pastor Dave Lasek. It's been an honor to be with you. If you have a church, I always say, serve it with your time, talent, and treasure. if you're looking for a church or feel like God's moving you to a different church, we would love to have you. We meet every week at 10 a.m. Sunday mornings, 251 Brookwood Road in the Venetia area, in Peters Township area, just off of McMurray Road there on Brookwood. And we would love to have you. Come on in and tell me, hey, I was watching your TV show. And what an honor that is for you to be our guest. God bless you. Have a great day.